Hello and welcome to the Semantically Cognitive Podcast. I'm Saahil, here with my co-host Swara. Today, we are delving into the intriguing world of metonymy. But before we jump in, Swara, what exactly is metonymy?
Just Google it.
Okay. So as you can see, we took the advice and Googled it. But here's the fun twist. Just Google it is in itself a metonymy.
That's right. When we say Google it, we are using the brand name to represent the broader act of searching or querying information online. It's a perfect example of how metonymy is ingrained in our daily language, even in the way we suggest looking up information. The brand becomes synonymous with the action.
It's all about those subtle linguistic nuances that make our communication so rich. Now let's dive deeper into metonymy and explore how it paves its way in our day-to-day lives. Explore an example that illustrates the connection between metonymy and cognitive semantics. Consider this example. The White House issued a statement.
Indeed, Sahil. In this instance, the metonym, the White House, is used to represent the US government's executive branch, conveying authority and official communication. Now let's unravel how this example aligns with the four key principles of cognitive semantics. The mere mention of the White House immediately taps into our embodied understanding of political power, government authority, and official communication. It's a direct link between language and tangible experiences.
Exactly, Swara. The White House and the US government exist within the same conceptual domain. This showcases how metonymy seamlessly involves substituting one concept with another within a shared conceptual framework.
The phrase activates our encyclopedic knowledge about government structures, political processes, and the institutional significance of the White House. It goes beyond a literal meaning, providing a nuanced representation.
Choosing to use the White House as a metonym involved a deliberate process of conceptualization. It's not just about referring to a physical building, but conveying the broader concept of governmental authority. Now let's explore a fascinating aspect of metonymy, its role as an access mechanism in cognitive semantics. Swara, could you break down this concept for our listeners?
Absolutely, Sahil. As we explored earlier, metonymy is often defined in terms of the conceptual access it provides. This idea is rooted in the work of linguistics like Kovacs, Radin, and Langacker. According to Langacker, the entity designed by a metonymic expression acts as a reference point, offering mental access to the intended target.
Exactly. John Croft builds on this idea, introducing the notion of domain highlighting. He suggests that a target within a domain is accessed by highlighting specific aspects of that domain. Think of it as shining a spotlight on a particular facet of our knowledge structure.
To illustrate this, let's turn to Croft's example involving Marcel Proust. In one instance, saying Proust spent most of his time in bed highlights the domain related to Proust as a person, emphasizing his habits. In another instance, Proust is tough to read, shifts the focus to a different aspect, Proust's literary work and career as a writer.
So metonymy, viewed through the lens of domain matrices, allows a single expression to metonymically highlight distinct yet related aspects within our encyclopedic knowledge. It's important to note that while metonymy involves highlighting a single domain, it's not the same as the cross-domain relationships we see in metaphors. Metonymy maintains a X stands for Y relation, emphasizing a connection within a single domain matrix.
And that wraps up our exploration of metonymy as an access mechanism in cognitive semantics. Let's be honest, just talking about it can be a bit mundane. It's time to spot metonymy in action. Let's hit the streets and explore some real-life examples together.
यार फोर्थ ईयर आ गया, आगे का क्या सोचा है?
हाँ मतलब मन तो मेरा यूएस में कहीं अच्छी जगह से पीएचडी करने का. तू बता तेरा क्या सीन है?
मैं तो सोच रही हूँ सिलिकॉन वैली चले जाओ, वहाँ पे टेक जॉब करनी
है. A little longer than a few minutes later.
आज मेस में डिनर बहुत खराब है.
हाँ यार कुफी वो तो सही होता है डिनर.
Hello,
passion that we fell into a rhythm where the music don't stop for life. Glitter in the sky, glitter in my eyes, shining just the way I like. Yeah, breakfast at Tiffany's and bottles of bubbles. Girls with tattoos who like getting in trouble.
Tesseract, to have power, unlimited power, and for what? A warm light for all mankind to share. And then to be reminded what real power is. Well, let me know if real power wants a magazine or something.
We have just scratched the surface of metonymy, and now we want to explore the relationships that give rise to these linguistic wonders.
According to Kovacevic and Redden, there are two main motivating relationships for metonymies. First, we have the part-whole and whole-part relationships. Take America for United States or England for the United Kingdom.
Those examples show how a part can represent the entire domain or vice versa. Now, let's talk about domain-part-part relationships within the domain of action. There are various such relationships, like to shampoo one's hair, where an instrument, which is the shampoo, represents an action.
And there's more. Agent for action. For example, to author a book. Then action for result. A deep cut. Manner of action for action. She tiptoed her way to the bed, and many others. These relationships provide unique access within a domain matrix.
Now let's talk about the principles that influence the selection of vehicles for metonymic relationships as proposed by Kovacevic and Radon in 1998.
The first principle emphasizes our anthropocentric perspective, where we tend to privilege human and humanly relevant entities and attributes as metonymic vehicles. Human vehicles are preferred over non-human vehicles in metonymic relationships.
That makes sense. Examples like Schwarzkopf defeated Iraq, where the human controller represents the entire military force, illustrates this principle. Similarly, he is reading Shakespeare, where the human producer is associated with the literary product. The second principle, concrete over abstract, suggests a preference for concrete vehicles in metonymy. Concrete entities or attributes are favored over abstract ones in forming metonymic relationships.
Absolutely. Instances like hold your tongue, for stop speaking, illustrate the use of bodily action over the abstract concept of language. Similarly, he is heartless, where a bodily attribute represents an emotional state. These principles provide generalizations that help us understand the patterns in selecting metonymic vehicles.
Now let's explore a fundamental question. How does metonymy differ from metaphor?
It's a crucial distinction, Saahil. While both metonymy and metaphor are cognitive phenomena that involve conceptual mappings, they operate in distinct ways.
Absolutely. Let's break down the differences.
Metonymy relies on a different core mechanism as compared to metaphor. While metaphor involves understanding one thing in terms of another, metonymy is about the association or contiguity between concepts. In metonymy, one concept is used to refer to another based on the proximity or shared context.
Precisely. For instance, in the metonymic expression, the White House issued a statement. We use the physical location, that is the White House, to represent the actions and decisions of the US government.
The conceptual relation in metonymy is often one of contiguity or association within the same domain. It's a part-whole or entity-context relationship, as we have seen in our examples.
In contrast, metaphor involves a conceptual mapping between two distinct domains. It's a this-is-that relationship where one concept is understood in terms of another. For example, time is money or the world is a stage. We have been delving deep into the realms of metaphor and metonymy. And now, let's explore their fascinating interaction in a phenomenon known as metaphtonymy.
Metaphtonymy, as introduced by Gossens in 1990, unravels the ways in which metaphor and metonymy interact within a conceptual system.
There are two primary ways in which metaphor and metonymy interact, and the first is metaphor from metonymy. In this interaction, a metaphor is grounded in a metonymic relationship.
An example that Gaussians provide is the expression close-lipped. It can mean silent, which directly follows from metonymy, since having one's lip closed is associated with silence. However, it can also take on a metaphoric interpretation, meaning speaking but giving little away. This metaphoric interpretation has a metonymic basis, as being close-lipped is standing metonymically for silence.
It's fascinating how these linguistic expressions can have layers of meaning, with metaphorical interpretations rooted in the metonymic relationships that underlie them. And this brings us to the end of this exploration. From exploring metonymy as an access mechanism within the principles of cognitive semantics to delving into relationships like part-whole and domain-part-part, we have covered the diverse facets of this linguistic phenomenon.
As we say goodbye, think of metonymy like the invisible artist in our language, quietly shaping how we express ourselves every day. So until next time, keep deciphering the linguistic symphony that surrounds us. This is Swara and Saahil signing off from the Semantically Cognitive.